his prayer was something else. Like, and you could tell that for him, definitely, I mean, when he says it, it really was, he's not just saying it, he experienced that. He was speaking to the one he loves. He was praying, but he wasn't really, he was praying in the same masjid as everyone else, but I don't think he really was with everyone else at that time. Right? He was somewhere else. Bowing is the slave bowing down before his master. These are just words. He was actualizing this idea in his prayer. Prostration, meaning sajda, is the ultimate submission, the feeling of nothingness and of humility to him. When a slave finishes the prayer, he offers the greeting, the salam, as a gift. Such is the trip that is filled with mysteries. Meaning that our prayer is supposed to be a trip. It's a trip. We've actually taken a journey and we've experienced things. Quran, understand this. The Quran says that the salah, innaha lakabiratun illa ala khashi'in. It's a big deal. It's hard for you. It's a hard thing for you, except until you get to the point when you have khushu in your heart. You have that feeling of softness, of submission. That's when the prayer will start becoming something else for you. So if we observe the prayer, if we just persevere, if we do it with the proper conditions, we give ourselves proper time, we do it on time, we make sure we have halal income, so everything that we're wearing, everything we're using is halal. We're praying our khums as well too. We do the proper acts of worship properly. We learn the rules of how to pronounce the prayer, etc. We'll see that. Okay, this is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll see that there's more to just the service level of the prayer. Please recite salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Another example of this, and inshallah I'll end with this example, of us trying, we have to understand, okay, remember, the goal of these series of lectures is for us to gain a deeper understanding. So what we're trying to understand here is that there's a deeper sense to the laws. Before I get to the point I want to make, I just want to tell you a story about this, that this idea applies to everything in this world, okay, more than just the laws. Like, you saw that example of Abu Qasim, right? One of my teachers was saying, and this is a reputable source, he was saying that one time in streets of Qum, there was a man who was walking and somebody riding on a bicycle, okay? And the person on the bicycle, you know, ran into the man who was walking. And it was really the person in the bicycle's fault for driving recklessly. So he runs into the guy who's walking. And he falls off his bicycle, and he's really upset at the guy who's walking. So he calls him a donkey, all right? Now, in the Farsi language, like, you know, it's I don't know, maybe I don't know, you know, maybe I haven't like spent enough time in Tehran or something like that, but it seems like the swear words are pretty mild, you know, and calling somebody a donkey is actually like a big deal, all right? So he calls him a donkey, right? Now, there was somebody who was there who was Ahle Batin, somebody who had, at times, he could see the interior of things. He could see beyond the surface level. And when he saw that this person who called, the bicyclist calls the person who's walking a donkey, he saw that in actuality, the bicyclist turned into a donkey. He turned into a donkey, right? Meaning that, what does that mean? Meaning that his soul turned into a donkey. Okay, that's the reality of him at that moment. Even though he's calling the other guy a donkey, because there was no, I mean, he was, you know, it was his right of way, he's a pedestrian, and he didn't do anything wrong. His getting upset at him, a fellow believer, and calling him names, that's haram, he turned into a donkey. Okay, so this idea applies to other things in this world as well too. There's a lot of examples. Even the Quran, you read the Quran, you see the other examples of people turning, for example, their likeness is that of a dog, or likeness is that of wolves, for example, etc. Now, the last point. Last example is this, and I keep on coming back to the marriage issue because as I said, it's a major crisis. And I want to make sure that even if brothers and sisters aren't ready for that, yet at least they have some of the principles in their mind. So, we see sometimes, okay, that people, young people, they befriend each other and they say that, okay, well, we're both Muslims and we want to get married one day, someday out there. But for right now, you know, we just want to kind of, you know, be like girlfriend, boyfriend sort of thing. Okay, so they said that, no, we're not doing anything wrong. We're going to get married someday. Right? Maybe even like their parents even know about it. Maybe they even know that, okay, they're going to get married, right? But until the point they get married, they're still hanging out with each other. They're talking to each other. They're like, you know, sharing Facebook profiles with each other or whatever it is. And they're like, they're SMSing each other. And, you know, they're always on the phone with each other. And they are getting personal with each other. They're getting emotional with each other. They're asking each other, how are you doing? And like, you know, being soft with each other. And like, you know, showing emotion and asking for sympathy and support without any Islamic contract having been read for them. Being that they have become boyfriend and girlfriend without any Islamic basis for doing so. And we see this happen a lot of times. Sometimes the culture encourages it. The culture doesn't want them to get married Islamically. Instead, they said, no, you guys, you can hang out, you can go out to eat, you can go out and be friends, but just don't get married until that day so that we can do it in front of everyone. And God forbid that we should do the M word. Okay? You know which word I'm talking about, right? All right? Because of the cultural stigma around that. So I have to say, brothers and sisters, that if we understand that there is an interior to the laws of Islam, then we can understand that by performing this contract, what is the contract? Okay, when a man and a woman want to get married, what happens? The woman says, she says that, will you marry me? Okay, she says that, I marry you on this condition. The man says, qabiltu, and it's done. How long did it take? 10 seconds. It's just words. So if we think, if we're just like simple, you know, naive, gullible Muslims, then we can say that, okay, it's just words, right? What's the big deal? A couple of words being said here and there, we'll say them later on, okay? In the meantime, just let us be, like, we'll have fun, you know, like we'll get to know each other, right? But if you understand that, no, there is a batin, there is an interior to the surface level. These words signify a world of meaning. They allow the mercy of God to enter into this relationship. They allow God, who is the controller of the human heart, to come in and say that, you know what? I'm going to make this wife, the heart of the wife and the heart of the husband, I'm going to make them compatible. The yin and the yang. Alright? If you understand that that's in the hands of God, then we will never even dare to go beyond just a business-like relationship with a non-mahram. Because we know that we're treading dangerous grounds. We're risking the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the deprivation of His mercy, and the risk of forever ruining that relationship that we have. You see, brothers and sisters, Allah promises us that we will have love between the marriages, between the two spouses in a marriage. And if we see that somebody doesn't have a marriage where the husband and wife love each other, the problem goes back to the way that they got married or the way they are conducting their married life. So let us be aware, let's take care and, you know, take a little bit of precaution and let's respect the laws of Islam. Give them the sanctity that they deserve. Remember, the laws are light, just like Allah is light. They come from Allah. Because they come from Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is nur samawati wal ard, the laws are light as well too. So they deserve some respect. They deserve sanctity. They are the means, they are the vehicles which will take us towards all of perfection and all of beauty. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to give the tawfiq to learn the laws of Islam, to apply them to our lives, and to then spread them to others. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.